All right, so hi everyone. This is going to be kind of odd, obviously, because since class is canceled today, I still wanted to give you a little bit of instruction for the 146 topics, but we're kind of doing a workaround here. So I'm actually at home recording this with my flip video, and we have our kind of document camera space here as though we were in class. But this we're just going to have to kind of muddle through for today. But basically, from section 3.2, there are a couple of things that I want you to be able to get when we're talking about measures of variation. And basically, with measures of variation, the idea is that we want to be able to quantify how spread out a data set is. So we want to be able to quantify the spread of a set of data. And there's a couple of different ways that we can do that. One of them we actually already talked about way earlier when we were doing the histograms. We talked about the range being the max minus the min values. So maximum value minus the minimum value for the set of data. And that actually is a really great way to get a quick and dirty estimate of how spread out a set of data are. The higher the value of the range, the more spread out the set of data. That being said, the range does have one definite disadvantage. And the disadvantage would be, since it only takes into account 2 points of data, it's actually not very good at coming up with an estimate of how all of the data is spread out. It only looks at these two values. So for example, if I'm thinking about a set of data that is, let's say, unimodal and actually pretty tightly grouped, like so, versus a set of data that is, let's say this is like 10 and this is 20 here. So let's say 10 here and 20 here. And then let's say I have the bulk of my data here, one other piece here, and then let's say I have an outlier over here. As far as the range is concerned, these two sets of data are the same, and they have the same amount of variation. The range for both of these is a range of 10, because if we take 20 minus 10, we get 10. But this set we can see is actually a lot more consistent. Well, let me rephrase. This set is unimodal and symmetric. This set is practically unimodal and all the data is right here, but we've got this outlier that's causing the range to look like it's the same as the first set of data, when really this set is actually more spread out on the whole than this set is. It's just that we've got this outlier in here that's making the range be the same. Okay, so that's the disadvantage of range, is it only takes into account those two pieces of data, and therefore we may not get the most accurate picture of how spread out the data are. That brings us to our better estimate of variance, well, of variation in a set of data, which if you watch the videos that I posted on the website from yesterday, we talk a little about the variance and the standard deviation. With these, I'm going to do a couple of things. First, in this video, I want to explain to you where these values came from and what it is that they're doing. And then in the next video that I make, I'll make a screen capture on the computer and show you how to compute these values on the calculator. Okay, but first, we're going to start with the formulas for them and where do they come from. We have different formulas for variance and standard deviation depending on whether we're talking about data that are from a population versus data that are from a sample. If we're dealing with population data, the symbol for variance is sigma squared, and it's equal to the sum of each data value minus the mean squared divided by the number of data points in the population. If we're talking about sample variance, it gets S squared as its symbol. And the computation is the same, roughly, but notationally we have a difference here. So we take each data value, we subtract the mean of the data values, which when we're talking about the sample mean, that's X bar, as opposed to the population mean, which is mu. And in order to get an unbiased estimator, this is something that Sal Khan covered on the video that I posted yesterday, instead of dividing by n here, we divide by n minus 1. Notice the n switches to a lowercase because we're talking about sample data instead of population data. Okay, so that's the variance. Now the standard deviation for each of these is just the square root of the variance. So for the population, its symbol is sigma, and it's the square root of the sum of each data value minus the mean squared divided by the population size versus, if we're talking about a sample, we would have square root of the sum of each data value minus the mean squared divided by n minus 1, whole thing underneath the square root, okay? So the question becomes, why is this the formula that we're using and what is it actually telling us? And so I want to kind of describe what's going on here. The standard deviation tells us, on average, how far away from the mean individual data points are. Okay, standard deviation tells us, on average, how far away from the mean individual data points are. So when I'm thinking about the formula for standard deviation, and I'm looking at what's going on, here we are. Couple of things to notice. First of all, if I wanted to know how far away from the mean a data point was, I would take the value of the data point, that's the x, and subtract the value of the mean, and that'll give me the distance between any individual data point and the mean. So that's where the part of the equation that's inside the parentheses comes from. Okay. If I want to think about finding, on average, how far away from the mean are all of these points, on average, I would need to add them all up and then divide by how many there are. Okay, so that's where the summing and then the dividing by n comes in. That's the finding the average. Usually the question that people have is, what's going on with the square and the square root? Why are those there? The squaring is there because when I take all of these differences, each individual data point minus the mean, some of those values are going to be positive. If we're looking at a data point that's above the mean, it's going to have a positive value for its difference. And if we're looking at data points that fall below the mean, they'll have a negative value here. If I add those all together just as they are, some are positive, some are negative, they're going to come out to be zero. So to avoid that and to be able to still find the average, I square all of those differences before I sum them so that when I add them all together, I get a positive value. Then we find the average by dividing by n, but at this point, the magnitude of this average is too big because we squared all of those differences. And so we square root it to undo the squaring.